Good morning and welcome to church here at St Andrew's. Welcome for those who have gathered together in the room. It's so exciting to be here together. And welcome also to those who are joining us from their lounge rooms. My name's Yana Robertson. I'm a regular attendee here at the 10 a.m. service. Today, singing with masks for those who are fully vaccinated returns here in the building. And I think the team's ready to rock it. It's going to be fantastic. Such a joy to gather in what is a new phase. Next week, kids are back at church. And for those of you who look forward to change and are anticipating always what's coming, this is super exciting. This week, I got back to interstate travel, which was at once really familiar and novel at the same time. But I was really energised by that. On the other hand, you might be a person for whom change and transition does not come easily. You might be wrestling with the need to make changes yet again in what has been kind of 2 years of permanent change. Our current sermon series is on the foundations of the church. And as we, the people, make up the church, it's at once collective and individual. The current series offers wisdom and solace for us all. For those of us who love change, it's a really important checkpoint to reflect on whether we're anchored firmly in foundations which will stop us from blowing this way and that. And for those of us who are inclined to change less, we can draw confidence that in the face of change, the character and nature of God is unchanging. And even as the world around us changes constantly, he doesn't. Let's just quickly pray before we get into singing. Father, thank you that you continue to work for the good of your creation, that you are a God of renewal. Thank you, Father, also that you go about your work in creation and in us, that even as you do that work, your character is as unchanged as it is perfect. Help us today to place our trust more fully in the firm foundation of your unchanging grace. Amen. All right, let's stand and sing.
When you goodness.
How good was that? I hope you were belting it out under your mask, and you're probably very happy I had a mask on, so it muffled me a little. all right. We have news that you get. Sorry, I got quite caught up in the music there for a moment. Weekly, we have news that comes out. You can receive it online. You can have it emailed to you, and there's also a video version of it. If you don't get the news, please just see someone in the office or see anyone after the service and we'll get you added to the list. You can catch up with all the most important news within our congregation by being tapped into that. We might just talk about our mission and aid partners for a moment. They're all up on the screen. We have lots of partners in lots of different capacities around the world, actually, doing very different and valuable work for the gospel. This week's particular focus goes to Mark and Rachel Collins. They have planted a church called Life Anglican Church in Marsden Park, and we support their work there and have done so for a very long time, actually. And so the prayer points in relation to their specific work can be found in the news this week. Of all of our giving, 10% goes to our mission and aid partners, and as a congregation we value the support that we're able to give others and to think beyond our own boundaries and our own suburb, and it's just so important. So if you are not a regular giver to the congregation but you are a regular attendee, and we would dearly love for you to partner with us in this way, and giving is done primarily electronically within our congregation. And just on that point, we held Foundation Day 2 weeks ago, and we had a number of specific causes that we were fundraising for. If you weren't able to join us on Foundation Day, can I encourage you to go back and actually watch the live stream of that particular service, because we really got to get a great insight into the impact that some of our partners have in our community, both here and abroad, and it was just such a blessing. The way Foundation Day works is we give a specific pledge beyond our regular giving to those causes, and we keep that open for a number of weeks. And so for those of you who have been able to participate in giving for Foundation Day, thank you. For those of you who are still thinking about it and haven't quite got the logistics sorted out, would you please try and attend to that in the coming weeks as we try and support those particular causes. And they're very reliant on our support, in fact, and we saw that in the videos. The only other announcement, hold your excitement, my family is beyond excited. Kids are back next week. And I think those of you at home who haven't been able to come because you're with your children, I know you're super excited and we can't wait to have you back in the building. So we'll see a trebling, I think, of our numbers next week with great joy. Let's continue on in our singing now.
Your name.
The Bible reading today is from Hebrews chapter 10 in full. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1. The law is only a shadow of the good things that are coming, not the realities themselves. For this reason, it can never, by the same sacrifices repeated endlessly year after year, make perfect those who draw near to worship. Otherwise, would they not have stopped being offered? For the worshippers would have been cleansed once for all, and would no longer have felt guilty for their sins. But those sacrifices are an annual reminder of sins. It is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Therefore, when Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you prepared for me, with burnt offerings and sin offerings. You were not pleased." Then I said, "Here I am. It is written about me in the scroll. I have come to do your will, my God." First, he said, "Sacrifices and offerings, burnt offerings and sin offerings you did not desire, nor were you pleased with them, though they were offered in accordance with the law." Then he said, "Here I am, I have come to do your will." He sets aside the first to establish the second, and by that will we have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. Day after day, every priest stands and performs his religious duties. Again and again he offers the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But when this priest had offered for all time one sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, and since that time he waits for his enemies to be made his footstool. For by one sacrifice he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. The Holy Spirit also testifies to us about this. First, he says, "This is the covenant I will make with them. After that time, says the Lord, I will put my laws in their hearts and I will write them on their minds." Then he adds, "Their sins and lawless acts I will remember no more." And where these things have been forgiven, sacrifice for sin is no longer necessary. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain, that is, his body. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. If we deliberately keep on sinning after we have received the knowledge of the truth, no sacrifice for sins is left, but only a fearful expectation of judgment and of raging fire that will consume the enemies of God. Anyone who rejected the law of Moses died without mercy on the testimony of two or three witnesses. How much more severely do you think someone deserves to be punished who has trampled the Son of God underfoot, who has treated as an unholy thing the blood of the covenant that sanctified them, and who has insulted the Spirit of grace? For we know him who said, "It is mine to avenge, I will repay." And again, "The Lord will judge his people. It is a dreadful thing to fall into the hands of the living God." Remember those earlier days after you had received the light, when you endured in a great conflict full of suffering. Sometimes you were publicly exposed to insult and persecution. At other times you stood side by side with those who were so treated. You suffered along with those in prison and joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property, because you knew that you yourselves had better and lasting possessions. So do not throw away your confidence. It will be richly rewarded. You need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he has promised. For in just a little while, he who is coming will come and will not delay. And, "But my righteous one will live by faith, and I take no pleasure in the one who shrinks back." But we do not belong to those who shrink back and are destroyed, but to those who have faith and are saved. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thanks, John. That was a long passage, but read very well. Friends, before I get into the talk, let me just add my welcome to Jana's given before. If you don't know me, my name is Mal York here. I'm the senior minister, and it's wonderful that you can join us today. Before I get into the talk as well, can I ask you to be praying for the staff this week? We're heading away for a few days on some staff planning days as we start to plan for 2022. So we're up in Lura till Wednesday. If you could be praying for us, that would be really wonderful. Well, today we continue to look at Hebrews and think through this topic of church. Last week we looked at Hebrews 9, where we saw that church was a reflection of the heavenly reality. But now as we move on to chapter 10, we see that church is a gathering to encourage believers. A few years ago, a lot of people were making comments about the way that I looked. People had said I had lost a lot of weight, and I'm pleased they noticed because I had. I'd lost about 20 kilograms all up. Some people asked me, did I have any health issues? And the truth is that I didn't really have any health issues. That's not why I lost the weight. However, when I answered, I do not have any, well, I do, but at the moment I'm keeping them at bay. For those who were not here last week, I shared that I have a genetic disorder called hemochromatosis. It's when a person's body takes in more iron than usual, and if nothing's done about it, then the iron can build up around my vital organs and I can die young. But thankfully, it's under control. But when I found out about it, I was actually very overweight. I weighed more than 100 kilograms. And so my specialist said to me I needed to lose weight. Otherwise, with hemochromatosis, it can lead to complications with my liver and so on. So in saying this, the doctor gave me motivation to do something about my weight. It was actually a real shock to me when I found out that I had this genetic disorder. I guess up until this point in my life, I probably had the view of myself that I was probably actually immortal. Maybe secretly I was Superman, and unlike everyone else, I wasn't going to die. But rather than being the Man of Steel, I was in fact Iron Man. But it really hit home that one day I would die like everyone else, or earlier if I didn't do anything about my health. It made me think of my wife and my kids, and by the grace of God, I wanted to grow old with them, and so I needed to start to look after myself. In saying this, I had a reason to do something about my weight. But you know what it's like when you lose weight, like a person who looks in the mirror and walks away and forgets what they look like. I initially did something about it. I lost a bit of weight, but I put it back on pretty quickly. But then people around me started to get really sick. People around me were dying. And it was when Heather was diagnosed in 2011 with cancer, I was reminded that if I do not do something about my weight, about my physical health, then I too could die an early death. I then heard on the news of a woman who was 30 who died from complications of hemochromatosis. In saying this, I was given a massive warning of what may happen to me if I did not act. Three aspects to start my physical health. I needed motivation, I needed a reason, and a warning. Three aspects to us that are applicable as to why we should come to church, why we should make coming to church a priority, especially as we think about our spiritual health. Friends, let me ask you today, how is your spiritual health? Today, as we look at Hebrews chapter 10, I'm hoping to give you the motivation, the reason, and a warning as to why we should make coming to church a top priority. So that regular attendance at church might be every week, except if you're sick or on holidays. And today, as we look at God's word, I'm hoping that you'll see that going to church is directly connected with our spiritual health, and shows the importance that church should play in our lives. But before we do look at this, let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, it is so wonderful to be able to come and look at your word today. And we pray that you will speak to us clearly by your Spirit. Give us motivation, the reason, and a warning as to why we should be making church a priority. But we pray that you'll speak to us now in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, if you do keep your Bibles open at Hebrews 10, if you've got it there, that'll be helpful as I refer to it throughout the talk. In the last talk, last week, we saw that church is when the body of believers are gathered around God's word. And as they do this, they're reflecting the heavenly reality, the heavenly church that is forever praising God and worshiping him. And so today, as we together gather around the throne of God, as we reflect this heavenly reality, we read in a passage the motivation for us to meet together. Can you see it there? If you've got it, it's in verse 10 of Hebrews 10. And it says this, "And by that will we have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all." You see, you and I have been made holy through the sacrifice of Jesus once and for all. Now, this may be a good indicator of our spiritual health. How holy do you feel? Do you feel set apart for the world, for the Lord Jesus Christ? Or is following the Lord Jesus Christ just one of the many extra things that you do in this world, such as a quilting or craft group, or maybe a sports team or a band or some sort of hobby that occupies your time but you discard if it gets in the way of other things? It can be hard, can't it, living 2,000 years after the death and resurrection of Jesus? It was so long ago. And sometimes because of that distance in time, the impact of it can feel less and less. Maybe we've been Christians for a while and we're starting to take for granted what the Lord Jesus Christ has done for us, and we lose the edge of our faith. But friends, we need to remember, it's for those who trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. We have gone through phenomenal transformation that can happen to any human being. For the Israelites, it was unattainable. If you've got your passage there, look at verse 1. The law was only a shadow of what was to come. It wasn't the reality. And then further on in verse 1, the sacrificial system could never make them perfect. You see, the sacrificial system that they had was a good reminder of what God required for people to be right with God. But it never quite got people there. They were never made perfect by it. Can you see there in verse 4, it says it's impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. It's like me with my hemochromatosis. It's impossible for me to get rid of iron any other way except by giving blood. If there was any other way, I would do it. I shared last week, I hate giving blood. But it's impossible for me to get rid of iron any other way. And as I said, if I did nothing about it, I would die. Or there's a shopping list of complications that I could look forward to. Impossible means there is no possibility. And this is the same with bulls and goats taking away humankind's sin. It's impossible. And if sin is not taken away, then we die for all eternity. That was the situation we were all in, friends, Jews and Gentiles alike. We were without any real hope of being made perfect or being made right with God. That is, until Jesus Christ came. A man who was God, who knew God and knew his will and his way. If you've got it there, look at verse 5. Jesus knew that God did not desire sacrifice and offerings, but that his body was what the world needed. A perfect sacrificial lamb, which had human blood in it, who could pay the price for human sin. Here the writer of Hebrews is quoting Psalm 40, verses 6 to 8, making Jesus the fulfillment of this psalm, as Jesus does his Father's will rather than his own. And it's in the Garden of Gethsemane that we might remember as Jesus faced his upcoming death, where he submitted to his Father's will, saying, "Not my will, but yours alone be done." You see, God does not want sacrifices and offerings that do not work, but rather he desires that people listen to him and do his will. They listen to his word and they obey what it says. Jesus was like this. He was perfect in every way. He followed God's word. He lived life according to God's will. And in the same way, God does not require us to make sacrifices of the things that we have for him, thinking that this will somehow make us right before God. But rather, he desires that we live according to his will and we obey his words. And so as we listen to his words, as we obey them, we give our lives as sacrifice to his will and word. We become living sacrifices. We need to remember that it's not because of anything that we've done that we're made right with God. It's only through the death of Jesus on the cross. By his blood that he shed, he made those who were full of sin holy in God's sight. It's God's word, it's not ours. Our obedience doesn't save us, but we obey because we have been saved. That is, you and I can stand before the God of heaven as people who are cleansed of sin right before his eyes if we put our trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, friends, this is the motivation that should lead us to meeting together. We should be motivated by the fact that we've been saved by Jesus, forgiven of our sin, a people who are redeemed by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, so that God's law is now on our hearts and penetrating our minds. And look at verse 17, and God will remember our sin and lawless acts no more. How good is it to know that everything that we've done, everything we will do, and everything that we will do in the future, although tainted by sin, will be forgotten by God because of what the Lord Jesus Christ has done. Such was the sacrifice of Christ. Such was the power of the blood that he spilled for us. The motivation for us to meet together is because, friends, in Christ, we are a new people, holy and set apart to do the will of God. Not to follow the ways of this world, not to follow our own desires, but to be his people, to be living sacrifices according to his will and his word in this world. And so we respond in obedience to him. Coming to church must never be about trying to get right with God in our attendance. We should never come to church in order to get a weekly fix or a weekly pickup, because it will not last. But rather, our motivation for coming to church must be in response to what Christ has done for us. Well, the passage goes on to give us a reason as to why we should meet together in verses 19 to 25. And it all has to do with the confidence that we've been given through our Lord Jesus Christ. If you've got your passage open there, the therefore at the beginning of verse 19 reminds us of the motivation that we've just looked at to gather together. That is, the fact that we have been cleansed from our sin by the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ should give us a confidence to approach the most holy place, a confidence that when we die and stand before our great God and King, we can know that we will be right with him and accepted into his heaven, a confidence to stand against the ways of this world, to stand up and live differently from those around us, set apart to follow God's commands and not the rules of this world. A confidence that when our life does come to its end, our hope is real and sure that we will be raised from the dead because of the work of the Lord Jesus Christ. Often people think that Christians come across as arrogant because of the gospel that we proclaim. But I think they mistake arrogance for our confidence. Before the 100-meter sprint of the Olympics in 2012, Usain Bolt came across to many as arrogant to some people because he claimed he was going to win the race. It's hands down, I'm going to win the race. But people were mistaking his confidence for arrogance. I mean, he was the world record holder. He had already won these races in the past. He had reason to be confident. But for me, if I'd acted like Usain Bolt, if I'd walked around saying, you know what, I'm going to win the 100-meter race here at the Olympics, I'm going to beat Usain Bolt, people would say, I'm arrogant because I've got no basis for saying what I'm saying. But we mustn't mistake arrogance for confidence. You see, Jesus has proven that he has entered the most holy place. He's proven that those who trust in him can be raised from the dead, that we will be made holy because he rose again himself as the firstborn, as fruits, as evidence of what he can do to us. He is the first fruit of the resurrection. And so because Jesus has risen, we can be 100% confident that we too will be raised from the dead because Jesus has promised us that this will happen and his word is true. Friends, if we put our confidence in the Lord Jesus Christ, we are putting our confidence in the right place. The passage then moves on in verses 22 to 25, continuing to give us reasons as to why we should meet together. And notice how they start with these words, let us. That is, as we respond to Jesus, as we respond in one voice, a new people responding to God together, this is church language here, what are we to do? Now have a look at verse 22. He says, let us draw near to God. In verse 23, let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess. In verse 24, let us consider how we might spur one another on. In verse 25, let us consider how we can encourage each other as we meet together. Here we're being called to be the people of God by drawing near to God, knowing that we've been cleansed by the blood of Jesus, and to seize the opportunity that Jesus has given us to draw near to God as we gather together. To listen to God's word in the Bible, knowing that his spirit will help us to understand what it has to say. To pray to God the Father because we've been given access by the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we should make the most of the opportunity of being able to pray directly to God himself. And do this together, expressing our unity in our ability to approach God. And to be unashamed of the access that we have to God. When people ask us about our faith, don't be ashamed. But say that it's as a result of the victory that Jesus has won for us. People can ask you at the most awkward times and you have to answer. One time I was doing a blood test and I sat down and the nurse said to me, as she got the needle ready to stick it into my arm, what do you do for a job? And then the needle went in. I thought, what do I say? Most response that I get from non-Christians when I tell them I'm a minister, it's a bit of silence, it's a end of conversation sort of thing. If she's anti-Christian, what's she going to do with that needle? Is she going to move it around a bit? I wasn't sure what to say, so I took a gulp and I said, I'm a minister at the local church. I didn't want to be ashamed. And so she ended up saying she hadn't been back to church for years. I encouraged her to go back. It was ended up being a nice conversation and she took the needle out, which was good as well. But the writer of the Hebrews says we're called to hold unswervingly to the hope that we profess, knowing that the hope that we have is true and certain. As sure as Jesus rose from the dead, so will we. And we have this wonderful hope of eternity in heaven, an inheritance that we read in 1 Peter will never spoil, fade or perish. Friends, this is so much better than anything this world can offer, anything this world can hope on. Yes, we might find wealth and happiness and fame in this world, but one day it'll all end. But the hope that we have is an eternal reward that will last forever. It starts in the here and now as we put our trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, but continues on for all eternity. And so hold out this hope as the most important hope that we have in the world today, and have this reflected in how we spend our time. We're called to spur one another on towards love and good deeds, to help each other live our lives as Christians, especially in the way that we act towards one another. Now, the word spur here is not necessarily a loves, hugs, and kisses word. A spur on the boot of a rider is used to prod the horse and to make it go faster. And this can hurt the horse a bit. Imagine having some sort of spur hit into you. When it says spur one another on, we're told to speak openly and honestly with one another in love about the way that we behave as Christians, to keep each other accountable in the way that we are living. Sometimes it might mean saying a hard word to someone or making a hard decision in order to correct someone for the way that they're living. In order to do so, we always must use the Bible to correct each other and rebuke each other. Any rebuke needs to be done in love and with God's word open. But why do we do that? Why do we speak to each other in this way? In order that we continue to move forward in our faith and we don't shrink away or become stagnant. And finally, we're called to encourage one another by not giving up meeting together. But we should be meeting more and more as we see the day approaching. This day that the writer of Hebrews is talking about here is the day of judgment, when Jesus will return. And so, friends, when we meet up and encourage one another, it's so important to help each other stand firm to the very end. Being involved in church should be the bread and butter of our Christian lives, because it's about meeting together to encourage one another to stand firm so that we're all found faithful on that final day. And in fact, should be so important in our lives, because we all want to be standing firm on that final day, that we fit other things into our lives around what we do at church. Friends, it should be the most important aspect of what we do in our lives, because it's through this we will spur one another on and encourage one another all the more as we see this day coming. Friends, these are the reasons why church is so important, because church will help us as we encourage one another to stand firm on this final day. Friends, no other earthly organization or activity will help you in this way. Well, the final aspect of this passage I'd like to look at today is how we're giving a warning as to what happens if we stop meeting together. Have a look at verses 26 to 27. Let me remind you of what it says. It says, "For if we go on sinning deliberately after receiving the knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a fearful expectation of judgment and a fury of fire that will consume the adversaries." Friends, I cannot be clearer about the dangers of someone who has heard the truth of the gospel, but who continues to sin, who continues to reject God, who continues to live a life walking away from his word in this world. And that's what I think continuing to sin means. I mean someone who willfully continues to live by rejecting God's word, not someone who tries to follow God's word and makes mistakes. We all are still full of sin. But who hears what God's word says and continues to willfully reject his word. All that person can hope for is a fearful expectation of judgment, a raging fire that will consume the enemies of God. This is the future for those who stop meeting together, who are not spurred on by one another, who continue to hope in the things of this world rather than of God, who continue to abuse the victory that Jesus has won for them. Verse 29 says that a person like this is treated unholy the blood of the covenant, the blood that Jesus shed on the cross for them. And then in verse 31, we're given this dire warning. It says it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Friends, it is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Revelation speaks about how the eternal destination for those who do not follow the Lord Jesus Christ all of their days is a lake of burning sulfur, where they will suffer for all eternity, and I don't want us to think otherwise. It's not a party with all our mates in hell. It's not some pitchfork-wielding devil that lets you indulge in your sin for all eternity. And it's certainly not in God's heaven if you continue to reject him and his word and his ways. A few years ago, I had a flue installed in our log fireplace back in Eastwood when we were living there. And a couple of times I opened it up to put wood on the fire. And I like to get the fire really raging, right? So it was really hot when I put the wood in. And on occasions, I've burnt my hand on the side of it, and it was really painful. But it serves to remind me of what happens to those who do not trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and what they will face for eternity. But friends, this is what we've been saved from. This might be a reality for those who reject God, but for us, we don't face that because of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we need to hear this warning. It is a dreadful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. What I'm concerned about is often we start out as Christians, passionate for God's name, being willing to do anything for Jesus. Like the original readers here in verses 32 to 34, they stood their ground when they faced suffering. They publicly exposed themselves to insult and persecution and joyfully gave up their material possessions for the name of Jesus. I mean, this is similar to us, isn't it? When we become Christians, we become involved in ministry. We evangelize our friends. We spend hours involved in the ministry of the church. But then issues come up. We get married. Family gets in the way. Sport gets in the way. We get into mortgage debt. And we need to upgrade that car. We've always wanted to buy that boat, let alone that new dress. And now we're eating out with our friends quite often at these top restaurants, and our kids want a new car. And it just goes on, and church just falls off the agenda. For some, they throw away the faith that they had. And sadly, I see this all too often in church. But friends, we need to be different. Listen to the words of verse 35. Do not throw away your confidence. Friends, do not throw away your confidence, but persevere. Do the will of God and you will receive what he has promised. Do not shrink back, verse 39 says, but be those who are counted amongst the believers in the very end. Friends, this passage gives us a clear warning as to why we should make coming to church and gathering around God's word and being encouraged by one another a priority in our life, the priority in our life. Because it's as we gather together, it's as we encourage one another to stand firm to the very end, we can consider how we can spur one another on. It's as we gather together, as we draw near to God, as we look at his word and pray to him and encourage each other to hold unswervingly to the faith we profess, that we will be standing firm on that final day. But friends, we need this sober warning, don't we? To remind us of the importance of gathering together and making it a priority. Friends, I hope you feel the weight of this warning. I hope you believe that God's judgment is coming in real. And I hope you remember that it's a dreadful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Well, let me conclude by saying, friends, let me urge you to use this passage as a constant reminder of the importance of why we should gather together every Sunday. Just like I was given a kickstart in my health kick, let me urge you to kickstart your spiritual health today. Make coming to church a priority, as I know many of you do. Get involved in the work of the church, not because it will save you, but because you have been saved and you desire to encourage one another and to spur one another on, all the more as we see the day approaching. Come with a mindset, not will you get out of church, will you get out of church, but rather how can you serve one another? How can you encourage one another to persevere? How can you, in your conversations with one another, be spurring each other on? Friends, do not come with a mindset, what is best for me, but being willing to submit yourselves to serving each other for the sake of one another. It's my hope and prayer that this passage today will give you the motivation for gathering together, the reason as to why it's important, and a warning as to what happened if we might stop doing this. But more importantly, friends, that you hear that this passage, what this passage says, and that you act upon it. Don't be like me who stopped doing things for a while and needed this big kick. But rather, friends, seeing meeting together with other Christians as the most important thing that you can do to help you stand firm to the very end, and let everything else take second place to this. But friends, we need God's grace and mercy to work in our lives. So let me pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we pray that you will work in our lives in such that we hear your word today. Help us not to be those who shrink away, but help us to be those who have heard the motivation as to why we should meet together and the reason, and heard this warning. And so help us to not stop meeting together, especially as we see the day approaching. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
As is our usual tradition, we're going to have a few questions. The number, if you have got some questions, is up on the screen. But we have some questions that have come through already, which is fantastic. So maybe I'll kick off with this one, Mal. The first one's about this Hebrews 9 and 10 being about the individual versus the corporate. Was it actually written for the church and for church life, or is it actually about being a Christian and for your individual Christian development more so?
I think it's both. I mean, church is always both, isn't it? It's about the individual development, and so we need to see what God is speaking specifically to us through this. But it's also the corporate nature of it. And I guess today I was arguing that that us language is very strong through these passages. And so I definitely think it is for the corporate church as well.
Perfect. Thank you. You talked first of all about motivation, and it seems without motivation it's pretty difficult to prioritise church. Have you got any practical tips on how we can stoke our motivation if it's waning?
Yeah, I think this is where the corporate nature of church comes in. Let's stoke each other. Look around, who's not here? Who are we going to call during the week? Who are we going to be encouraging during the week? Let us gather together. Let us spur one another on. This is a corporate thing. Church is not about me. Church is not about the staff team. Church is us as a gathered body, and we all have that responsibility to see who's not here and to be chasing people up and to be talking with people and things like that. That's what church is about. So the motivation, let's be motivating each other. Let's be talking with each other about it.
And then, Mal, following on from that, I guess, for those who have some doubts as to the reason you talked about that confidence, is there a place for them in church and
absolutely. There is such a place for those who are doubting, who are sceptical, for those who aren't believers yet, because we want to help you. We've heard the warning and we're responding that way. We want you to hear this warning, and we want to help you to have confidence as well. And sometimes that takes time, and that's okay. We're not rushing people here at church. This is a time when we can gather together and we can encourage you as well in these words. But for some people, that confidence takes time. But yeah, our aim is to help you to have that confidence, absolutely.
And then, Mal, finally, I guess, on the warning that you gave, this question goes to that. It says, is hell talked about metaphorically rather than literally, more an absence from God than fire?
Yeah, I was quoting to you from Revelation before. So Revelation is pretty graphic. When Jesus talks about hell, he talks about Gehenna, and he talks about a fire that never goes out. I take God's word in that way to be what it is, and so I feel that it's probably more literal than metaphorical.
Thanks, Mal. That's fantastic. And Camilla is going to come up and lead us now in prayer.
Thanks, Jana, and thanks, Mal. So great to see everyone in the building. And as we've heard from Mal today, we have God's assurance that through the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross once for all, we can be fully forgiven and he will remember our sins no more. So now let's take an opportunity to come together in prayer, starting with the confession of our sins, so that we can, as the passage in Hebrews said today, have confidence to draw near with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, that our hearts are sprinkled to cleanse us from guilty conscience and have our bodies washed with pure water. So please say with me the words on the screen. Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Merciful Lord, grant to your faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you with a restful mind through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Oh, Heavenly Father, thank you for the gift of your Son and for your good plan to save us through the sacrifice of his life for us. Thinking of Remembrance Day on the 11th of November this week, we also thank you for the sacrifice of thousands of men and women of the armed forces who have lost their lives or endured suffering, serving others in times of conflict. Please grant veterans and families that grieve the loss of loved ones in war your comfort and peace, and bless us all with your wisdom and guidance to be peacemakers in our broken world. As the challenges of human impact on the environment and the opportunities for us to pull together as nations to preserve your beautiful creation have come more clearly into focus with the COP26 meeting, whilst the pandemic and the great need of vaccines in developing nations continues in our world, please grant leaders in our federal and state governments and globally wisdom from you, a heart for others, and the guidance and courage to make difficult decisions according to your will. Turning to your church, please help us to hold unswervingly to the hope we profess for you who promised our faithful. In this period of transition from lockdown to meeting back together on site for your church in Roseville and beyond, may we continue to encourage one another, keep meeting together in fellowship, and spur one another on toward love and good deeds so that we continue to joyfully share our hope with others. As our church prayer for this week reads, Father in heaven, keep your household, the church, steadfast in faith and love, that through your protection it may be free from all adversities and may devoutly serve you in good works to the glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In this, we bring before you the work of our mission partners, Mark and Rachel Collins at Life Anglican Marsden Park. Thank you for the provision of the school hall and community centre in which to meet, and we pray for them as their congregation returns to meeting together and they hope to become a provisional parish in 2022. Lord, we are also very grateful for the many activities conducted at St Andrews, and thank you for our faithful and hard-working ministry team in this very challenging year. We pray for your blessing over them as they meet in Lura to plan for next year together in this coming week. And thank you that we can be together again here in the building and also online and sing today with joy. We also give you great thanks that Kids Church can begin again next week on the 21st of November. Please give Mel and the leaders your wisdom and renewed energy as our children enjoy the great blessings of being together again, having fun, and learning each week to walk more closely with you. Father, we praise you for Lauren Vandermeer and thank you for her faithful and gifted service over many years at St Andrews, building our youth ministry with her husband Grant. As she finishes her vocational ministry at church, please make this a time of peace and joy for her and the family as she focuses on future plans. We also pray for the HSC students at St Andrews and throughout New South Wales this week and the families supporting them. Help them to know your presence and bless them with maintained health and focus whilst they study and sit their exams. And finally, Lord, we give you thanks for the arrival of Jasmine and Layla Valentine to Andrew and Deb on Wednesday. May they be surrounded with your love and presence as they settle in together at home. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And finally, let's conclude by praying together the prayer that Jesus taught us, and the words are on the screen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Thank you.
Just can't wipe the smile off my face. The singing is just such a joy to be part of. Mel began the sermon by reminding us that church is a gathering to encourage believers. I pray that you've been encouraged today. I certainly have been. And I pray that you're also encouraged to spur others on. For those who haven't been here to join us today or who haven't been around for a while, I pray that you will be called to check in with some folk and encourage them along in their walk so that they can join us next week. For those at home, we'd love for you to check in via the QR code. We know that that check-in has been a really important part of church as we've done it virtually and as we transition to coming back to more in person. Now, if we can just finally finish with the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.
Christ.